go to sleep, dream your best dreams, and wake up by day when people will, if you have questions. The work is a collaboration between myself and Holger Schanz, and I'm going to speak about delay times with a star, which will be explained, and I'll delay times and their distribution, and I'll talk mainly on one example, which is how problems which have quantum localization are different from those which they don't have any analog, that is the classical time delays problem. The work is partially described in two papers which we wrote, and they are published in the Journal of Physics, A. And the star stands for those of you who are used to speak about the Wigner delay time. Wigner is not delay time, it is a mean delay time. And the delay time, you can talk about the distribution only if you are looking at the average properties of an ensemble of systems. Each system has its own Wigner mean delay time. I'm speaking about a single system, and I'm speaking about the distribution of delay times caused by the dynamics, not by averaging over an ensemble of systems. Just to explain, I'll start with this, a classical Gedanken experiment. You have a start line, and you have runners which are going, starting, they run the balls which are perpendicular to these lines, and they have to get perpendicular to this line, and when they reach this end line, there is a stopper which measures the time. So here is one trajectory, this is another trajectory, another trajectory, and yet no. And then when you just accumulate all the, you measure all these delay times, and you accumulate the probability in a certain bin, you find a distribution. Notice I didn't do anything to the system. It is a single system, and I'm only examining it in this kind of a process. And what I would like to describe is this distribution. This problem became quite timely in the last few years because people in optics and laser physics were able to achieve experimentally very, very narrow pulses. And the very narrow pulses are up to such times where the coherence and the typical time scale of the motion of the targets becomes comparable, and therefore you must use quantum mechanics, you cannot use classical ideas. And they measure such things as tunneling delay times and various other things, and therefore I think there was a little confusion about the proper theory for which one can use. There were at least four or five theories proposed. All of them gave different results, so I just looked at it again, and I would like to present a coherent theory for this particular problem. So I would like to switch from classical dynamics to quantum dynamics. And again, we have a beam, and we have a short pulse, but it is a wave packet. And then it comes from this direction, and then there are all these possible optical rays which are drawn here, and then you have an angle going at a final angle theta phi, and you would like to you monitor the time which it took from this pulse, very well defined in terms of time. Your detector also is very high resolution, and you get again a picture. And I would like to see what is the difference between the quantum picture and the classical picture. Now, quantum mechanics and time are not very good friends. As you know, people are divided between whether time is a parameter or whether time is an observable. So who thinks it is a parameter? Good. Who thinks it is observable? Me. Now, to make the thing even more drastic, and maybe, can you stop me 5 minutes before the time, please, just to tell me? But never mind the time, if I don't finish, I just want to excite you in saying that, to ask John Keating, he's a famous professor, what is the in one dimension, what is the observable, the operator which corresponds to observable of position? But what is the operator which gives you the distribution of positions? What is the operator which corresponds to the classical x? X? Okay, no, you're wrong. In two ways. Everybody is wrong in two ways in this. Because when you say x, you have to say relative to which point. Okay? You have to say, where did you have your coordinate zero? This is one. And the other one, when you speak about an operator, you also have to say which Hilbert space it is working in. Otherwise, it's not an operator. And therefore, this is a problem which we all know how to solve, and we work with quantum mechanics very well. In time, it means that we have to take the time degree of freedom. To my mind, it's a degree of freedom. You have to determine where did you start measuring time, and you have to determine which space of functions you are working so that you can really measure time. And time is then become an observable. So what I claim is that you can do it, and I'll try to convince you that one can do it. So is it observable? Is it a parameter? What is the operator of T? Well, there are many questions. I'd like to show you my solution to this question, and I'll do it in a few steps. First of all, how to define delay time independently of the experimental geometry in the classical ray and the quantum wave description. So far, we defined it in this way just by stopping the clock and opening the clock. But this is, you have to speak about the delay time in a consistent way. You could do it quite easily in classical physics. Quantum mechanics, a little bit different. And in the wave setting, it is quantum or optical setting, it should not offend uncertainty principle, the description. And the delay time distribution is dependent on the envelope of the incoming wave packet. You see, you must have a wave packet. And this is the answer to the question, how do you define an observable in terms of proper acting on a certain space of functions, and the space of functions which are determined in this or necessary for this description is to take proper wave functions, wave packets, namely, the wave packets should be then integrable, and if you are integrable and have the good properties, then you can actually take the observed time. Time, by the way, can be measured. When I was an experimentalist, I measured the lifetime of nuclear states. I have a paper on it. So if I measured it, it is something which can be measured. Not to speak about relativity, I just want. Okay. And then the answer to the above should be consistent also. We have two pictures, the quantum and the classical, and the correspondence principle says that they should converge to each other in the right limit. And the question which I would like to answer is, what happens in phenomena where there is no, when the scattering that we are looking at, like in Anderson localization, has no classical analog. It is a genuine wave phenomenon. So this will be the last line. Now, how to define delay time independently of the experimental geometry in the classical and the quantum wave prediction? So classically, we have this kind of a scattering array, and we have another scattering array. And then we can say that the delay, the difference between this ray and that ray in time is just what happens if you take the incoming wave, we look at the part which was scattered, and find the difference. And if you want to take this picture in a more formal way, you can write the action integral, and you take the derivative of the action between the incoming and outgoing final conditions, for example, the incoming angle or the angle outgoing angle, and then you see that you define a proper classical delay time in which the time that you measure at the end and the time that you measure at the beginning, their difference is being corrected for the free motion. So you are independent where you started the measurement or you ended the measurement. It measures only that part of the time where the particle or the system are interacting with each other. quantum mechanically, well, what you do is to take a wave function which has an incoming component and outgoing component. The incoming component you take as a wave packet, a pulse, which is directed along the initial condition. And then you can write it in this way, where omega k is an envelope function, which I demand that it be normalized. And it has typically k0, which is the carrier wave band, wave number, and sigma, the bandwidth. And that defines my space of functions, where I'm space functions in time at which I'm working. And the monochromatic limit, sigma 0, is the bedtime resolution limit. So there is no good good resolution. But it is a monochromatic, and these are the rays that we are always striving for, at least in the when you use acceleration, accelerators, and such things, you want always to have very good energy definition. This is the limit of bedtime resolution. Sigma goes to 0. So quantum scattering operator is measured, is written in this way. And you notice that this is really the Hamiltonian or the evolution operator in the interaction representation. What does it mean? It means that you propagate with the full Hamiltonian and you subtract away the free Hamiltonian. This is exactly the idea of a delay. You don't care where did you start, you don't care where you stop, because the full operation, you subtract out of it the asymptotic incoming and outgoing dynamics. And therefore, you can see it also, if you write now the outgoing part in the usual way that we are writing it, it is the overlap over the wave packet times the outgoing S matrix with outgoing wave. S, by the way, I'm speaking here, so I didn't say it, about light propagation. So I can always use S is the time times classic, times the velocity of light. And then the scattering matrix is completely characterized, completely characterizes the scattering event. It has unitarity. And because of that, what I would like to say is the probability to observe a time S in a transition from omega I to omega F in an interval of omega F delta omega is equal to the absolute value square of the out wave function times the delta omega. And if you write it down, you find that you get that this is equal to 1 over 2 pi integral decay of the wave packet appearing here, S matrix e to the minus I k s prime, and then integral, I don't know why it's prime, it should be S, d omega. Now, because of the normalization of the packet envelope and the unitarity of the S matrix, you find there is a probability conservation. The probability, by the way, is positive. It's very nice. Probabilities should be positive. And then also, this is the right normalization. You integrate over all the times and integrate over all the final directions to which you scattered, and you get 1. That's very good because you started with 1 as an incoming wave. You can rewrite this thing in a slightly different way. You can write it as a correlation function of the S at energy psi minus eta over 2 and psi plus eta over 2. And then you have also to weigh it with the product, proper product, of the enveloped functions and take the Fourier transform of this. And then you can rewrite it in, if you take the Gaussian, standard Gaussian wave packet envelope, then you write it in this way. And finally, you get this closed expression, where here is the correlation function with the Gaussian weighting. And then you take the Fourier transform again on a finite domain determined by the wave packet conditions. So this is the message that you have to take home. You can measure time. This is the time distribution. It corresponds to the classical distribution. It depends only on time delay and not on the initial conditions because of the way the S matrix is defined. And you can write it explicitly in this way. Such ideas were written in various ways before. Lyubochitz in 1983 have offered this in terms of, he wrote it down in terms of nuclear physics. So he was interested in the effect of resonances, and he wrote the S matrix in terms of the energy distribution in the complex plane, and he got to a similar expression. I had with Reinhold Blümel in 88, we wrote this, and I gave a lecture on it in. And there is also a more recent paper by Hart and Antonsen, but also in the solid-state physics community, this was mentioned, and I'll mention the reference later on. Now, what are the properties of this function? First of all, it is properly normalized, and it's positive, which is very nice. Secondly, let us look at the monochromatic limit, sigma goes to zero. If sigma goes to zero, you just can perform this integration and compute the first moment. The first moment is the mean. And the mean is equal to 1 over n trace S matrix, derivative of S matrix star. This is a known expression for the Wigner-Smith mean delay time. So you see, it is a mean. It is not a it is not a delay time. It is a mean, and it appears in this. And it cannot be a delay time because it is in the monochromatic limit. So the energy is very well determined. So it's only the mean. But you can ask also another question: if this is the wave, if this is the probability, you can also compute the variance, and then you do the computation, and you find 1/σ². When sigma goes to zero, this goes to infinity. But it is what you would expect. If you have a pulse which is very broad in time, then you can broaden it a little bit again. But still, the resolution, the delay time cannot be determined. It is all zero. So this is a point which shows connection to what that this theory offers the correct meaning when you take the various limits. And if you look at the original paper of Wigner and Eisenbud, I think, from the early 50s, you see that he actually is assuming monochromatic behavior. He just takes the wave function and pushes it a little bit by the energy, and by this he computes this expression. This is not the same as Smith derived it, but it is about the same thing. So how is the correspondence principle? I promised you that it should satisfy the right limit. But then you can use the semi-classical theory for the S matrix, and you write it in terms of all the sum of all the paths which are going from here to here, and you add them with the right phase. And then if you take the limit where the sigma is less than the carrier wave and much larger than one, is a narrow pulse limit, then you can get this term plus interference terms. But if you erase the interference terms, you get the classical distribution. L alpha are the paths which are just the paths which are going here. So you get the semi-classical theory because P alpha is the amplitude which is carried by each path. So the classical limit is achieved. And now I'm going to an experiment. So this is, in summary, the theory. This is what I propose as the means to compute the probability, the time delay probability, and define it properly. Maybe I can ask for questions now, or you prefer the end? Yes? Well, yes. That's what it does. It's very similar to the Wigner function in time. If you look at the expression, it is very similar to it. But it is a consistent theory, and there is no problem if you have if you use the S matrix to describe processes which are classically not allowed, good for you. You'll have tunneling, but it is all in this formalism. Now, Barry. So now I'm going into Anderson localization. Yes. Yes, because it is yes, it is. The operator is defined by as a limit because then you want to go to the energy shell. When you go to the energy shell, you get something which depends on energy. And then when you have something which is going, you can multiply it by any wave packet. The wave packet also, the integration goes to infinity. However, the wave packet amplitude goes to zero. This is what you do when you want to measure any operator. So Michael and Susanna Klein, right, did an experiment back in 1992 maybe, in which they took a stack of transparencies, you know, foils, and they put them together one after the other, and then they shined a laser light from one side, and they measured the light which comes out from the other side. However, there was some radiation, of course, which was backscattered. Now, because of the fact that there are little air spaces between the transparencies, here, this is a transparency. There were different widths also, different depth widths, because they are not uniform. And here, there was a little bit of air. So there is each of the spaces is a scatterer, and each scatterer has the probability to back scatter, to forward scatter. The material which they used was apparently very good, so there is no absorption almost. And then they measured the intensity of light coming out as a function of the number of foils that they used. And what they did was, and what the results were these beautiful lines, which they fitted to the theory of Anderson localization for the transmission. And you see that this is a demonstration that the Anderson theory for this particular system can be written exactly. And the secret here is that the result is not due to absorption, this the decaying strength, but it is due to multiple scattering, which appears here, and to the fact that when you have multiple scattering and you are looking in the forward direction, you can have different rays which have the same length, and therefore the interference, but they can also interfere positively or negatively. And the balance between positively or negatively, and the balance between the amplitudes, which are different because of different positions of scattering and different ways of scattering, they are the ones which combine together to give Anderson localization. Anderson localization is an interference property, and the randomness helps you to sum up the effects in an effective way to see a simple exponent. So what we would like to do now is to replace this experiment by an experiment of the kind which I was demonstrating at the beginning, namely, here is the incoming beam. It is a pulse this time, of very well defined in time. Here is the Barry Klein experiment. We don't measure here. This stack goes to infinity. But we measure the backscattering. And we put a detector here. And we measure the time distribution in which radiation will hit, will come, subject to this incoming light. Such an experiment was actually done in microwaves by the people in Maryland, but I don't think it is ever published. It was not conclusive, I think. But I don't know if people in graph theory or in waveguide, you can do it with waveguides, and maybe Barbara, you can do it when you go back to China. So how the problem then is to compute a delay time distribution, I of t. It is completely wave property. It is not a classical property. And we shall have to do it somehow. So in order to do it, we have to repeat this argument which Michael was and Susanna were putting in the picture, but they do it in a quantitative way. And that is to look at the backscattered trajectories. Here is one. It goes on the red and goes back on the black, red, black, red, black. And what matters is how many times you stayed in a certain width between the transparencies. Now, you don't have to look at the black because every red have to be reversed in order to be here. So the numbers M1, M2, M3, and 4 can be read out if you only have the forward going arrows. And here is indeed another situation, a trajectory, in which the same widths M1, M2, M3 occur, but geometrically they are different, and therefore they interfere. So there are isometric but geometrically distinct trajectories, and all these have to be added up coherently to get the answer. Assuming the widths are incommensurate, so the widths are incommensurate, the lengths are uniquely given by the sum, or twice the sum, of the m's times the corresponding lengths, or widths, li. So this gives the phase for each of these. So all the phases here, the phase here and here, are the same. And we have to look at the interference. And we can define a topological time that we can measure here. Topological time is just the sum of the m's. It is the number of scatterings. And there is a metric time, which is equal to twice LIMI. Each width here has to be taken MI times. Okay, this is a combinatorial problem which we have to do. And then we have to also to say in our model what will be the matrix, scattering matrix in each elementary scattering point. And we can take this simple scattering S matrix, and we can take them take it with uniform, so independently and uniformly distributed on the circle of on the TIs, and then each scattering matrix is identified by the probability to transmit or to reflect. And then what we shall do is to compute this average over these phases or the scattering elements and get an answer. So what we have to do is to write the scattering matrix in for this one-dimensional problem. We have a transition element T0 to come into the from the left. We come into the scatterers, then we propagate and we do all this the possible things, and then we go out. And alpha, the trajectory, is given as the succession of edges. This we can call this edge, succession of edges which we are traversing at each point. The total length is equal to the sum of all the edges. And the amplitude for each term here is equal to the product of the scattering matrices at each successive boundary which we hit. So this is the matrix. And then we can also think about now two different situations. Let us assume first that all the lengths are incommensurate. Of course, this we assume. Then the length of the walks come in families of isometric metric walks, as we say, isometric walks, which I already mentioned before. And they are characterized by vectors of indices. M1 in the first, M2 in the second, Mn in the nth width. The length is this. And the and if you want also that topological time t is equal just to the sum of m's, and this I call absolute of m. So here is what we are interested in computing. We can break it up to sum over all the orbits which have n collisions, or n this capital N, this is 2n here, and then we can rewrite this by looking at all the families which have length to n, and then we have e to the iklm, all of them have the same length. However, the products of the sigmas appear here as the coherent sum. So Anderson localization comes from this coherent sum only. And then the question is how to make this summation. And this is what I wrote. I said the mu A takes both signs, resulting in a complicated interference which is due to, which brings about the Anderson localization. Now we do a trick. At this point, we look only at the topological time. And what I can guarantee you that if we look at the accumulated probability to observe a time t from 0 to s, then if we look at the point, if we take L to be the same L for all, the same Li for all the L's, which means that we have, therefore the lengths are really proportional to the topological time, we have this inequality. We can calculate the actual cumulative probability to find S, and it is bounded from the two sides by having either the topological time distribution corresponding to the minimum length in this distribution of Li's and the maximum one on this side. And this is explained here. If you reduce all the, if you increase all the lengths, all these lines are changing upwards, and therefore the distribution goes down. And this is what we say here also. So this is very simple. And having this result and using all the combinatorics which you can harness and which we did back in 2000 with Holger Schanz, we can get the following answers. The classical probability distribution is proportional to t to the minus 3/2. This is quite normal and expected because after all, t to the minus half is the probability to return. And then you have a probability to transmit. When you return, you don't know if you return back or go outside. And therefore, this is t to the minus 3/2 is a natural result. But anybody can guess what will be the result for the proper Anderson model result? And the people from Dresden and Bristol should not participate in, to the, are not, this question is not addressed to them, because they know the answer. So, anybody wants to bet an answer? No? So, what are the stakes? I don't have any stakes. Usually I offer a Schwarzwälder Kuchen, but in Brazil, a Schwarzwälder Kuchen is not recommended. I cannot recommend any. So, do you think it is an exponential, or do you think it's a power law? No? Yes. Sorry? Yes? What is exponential? Do you anybody thinks it's exponential? Who exponential will raise his or her hand? Exponential. Good. Who for power law? Nobody. What a pity. Sorry. You are Larry, you are right, and also Kaplan, you are right. It is 2 to the minus 2. And the reason, you see, this pulse is broader than this pulse. But still, it is not broad enough, and this is what happens. So, this result is what we have so far. We tried to look for further answer, but then we were not able to continue any further for various reasons, but I'll come to it later. Now I can add, now the same result was found in a series of papers by Titov and Benacker, who did a completely different approach. And you might know these papers from. It is the group around Benacker who, and I think also Shomeros was involved in one of these, in some of these papers. So this is not a great surprise, but it comes naturally in the way that we are doing it. And here you can see simulations, and I promise you that even if you don't look at the details of the simulation, they prove that the analytic theory is correct. So, it's a little thing. Okay, when you have classical delay distributions, you can also ask it this question in a finite graph. What will be the delay in a finite graph? And there you can write a compact answer. which the delay time will go like classically, will go like e to the minus a minus gamma t. And you can get a and gamma from the connectivity of the underlying graph and from the length distribution. And this is something which was done by Kiro, Smilansky, and Smilansky, and therefore I'm very happy to present it to you. The other Smilansky is my son, and you can see it here. 5 minutes, good, I finish. Open question, and to be done. Very Klein setting, the distribution of metric delay time, so we didn't do it, we looked only at the topological time, and it depends on the dimensionality, to do it as a function of a dimension, I don't know. One can do it, one attempt which is related to this is whether one can do it on a tree. I think that Grisha was trying to do the combinatorics on the line, which we did with Holger, to expand it to the tree. And as far as I remember, it did not reach to any conclusion. But you are most welcome to restart to do the computations if you have the old programs. But it is a very complicated combinatorial problem. We needed really to invent new identities in order to get the result. I mean, not me, Holger Schanz. He really did a wonderful work, really tour de force of combinatorics. Another question of practical information of problem is the role of dissipation. We assume that there is no dissipation. How does dissipation affect it? Oops, why is this? Unable to connect to box. I'm very sorry, I don't want to connect to box. So how do you get rid of this? Okay, let's leave it as it is, who cares? Sorry? Oh, there is a cross over there. Well, are you sure? Yes, I'm sure. Ah, I know why. I put it on thank you for your attention. It's like, hey, stop. Oh. Stop. I didn't finish. Okay, I have a lot of time, right? Okay, go ahead, ask questions. Let's ask, open for discussion. Yes. Yes, I did. So, what about? Yes. Well, look, if you just put the Hamiltonian in as E, then you get the right commutation. Because so if you look at the, I think that the result is if you look at the expectation value of the commutator, you'll get the right answer. If you take wave packets. Yes? Yes, right. Yes. Good. I forgot to say that, you see, I here there are two papers. In the first paper which I wrote, I've done it for the relation between energy and momentum. Yeah, but I dispersion relation, but being old, I don't have all the terms at hand. You can do it for the two dispersion relations. You have to be careful because when you have the quantum mechanics, the dispersion relation is not as it is for light, then you will have to take into account the fact that a wave spreads in time. So there is another limitation to the length that you can pass, but otherwise you can do it, and I did it. It's all in great detail in this paper.
Comment, it's interesting that we get this power law and its underutilization.
because it is a complementary experiment. It is different. Yeah, but it was about, you see, you changed the stack size, and here we look at it at the time, and the time can be a long delay can be also achieved by a short. So it's a different kind of averaging. Yes, Grisha. Yes. Right. Over. Some. Right. Yes. Yes, but you're most welcome to try. No, seriously, you see, because of some reasons that I don't want to go to them, the project is now on stop until things will become better, but this is one of the plans to be done. And what I also can say is, you see, the most apparent difficulty is when you have delay, when you have when you have a barrier penetration. And there, you see, if you have if you want to define time properly, you have to have a large energy distribution. But if you have a large energy distribution, that you might be over the barrier in part, and therefore the integral will be completely determined by the above barrier part. And if you change, then you don't have good time resolution. So the whole question of the time that it takes to pass through a barrier, to my mind, is not well defined. You have to accompany it with a statement about what is the incoming wave packet with. Otherwise, there is no meaning. You write the problem as a Fourier analysis, and then in the Fourier space there is a lot of energies, and then you take energy by energy and you do the computation. You can create the S matrix per energy, and only then you are doing the Fourier transform. So then you can have as many parts as you wish. You mean the referee on the 2000 paper mentioned it, and we looked at it. There are differences because we used a different combinatorical approach. Yeah, I don't know. I don't remember how he did, but the combinatorics was different. The way of counting was different. Yes, right. We quote him. Yes, I know. Yes, well. Yes. Right. No, I do even. No, you see, I'm saying that the probability to find a time, as it is defined, is the absolute value squared of psi tx, and then. So then I can calculate its moments, and the moment is the mean, a square, and which operator do I put? For the moment, I put t, t square, and then I use it. I use the way that I define the space in terms of integrals over energy to get a wave packet, forces me to calculate the integrals. But I'm looking at the expectation value of t square, of t cube, etc.